Welcome, geeks and nerds, girls and boys, to a brand new edition of Geek to Me Radio. Today, we're joined by actor, writer, director Mykee Morettini, talking about his brand new film, Evil Everywhere. We'll then do our Pensacon wrap-up with our friends from Tatooine Sons. All that and more, stand by.
We're talking TV, comics and movies, and video games. Star Trek from Star Wars, we'll try to explain. There are 12 doctors, 4 Hogwarts houses, 1 ring rules them all. To be the greatest Pokemon master, you must catch them all. You must catch them all. Try to catch them all. Gotta catch.
If you're driving around the greater St. Louis area right now, listening to us on the big 550 KTRS celebrating its 25th anniversary of broadcasting, we appreciate your listening. If you're watching this on Instagram Live, hello to you. If you're streaming us on YouTube and Twitch and Facebook, hello, and thanks for watching there as well. And if you're hearing this after the fact in the podcast form, thank you for subscribing and listening there. We do appreciate each and every one of you. We've got a brand new show tonight, obviously, live show, and we're going to talk right now to our first guest, writer-director of Evil Everywhere, which everyone who knows me knows I'm a horror movie fan, so I'm very excited to talk to Mykee Morettini. Did I say that right, Mykee Morettini?
Yeah, you did. You said it.
Perfect.
Exactly right.
Yeah. Thanks so much for being on the show tonight. I appreciate the time, and I'm a huge horror fan. It's one of those genres that I feel like if you get it right, you get it right. And if you don't, it's still fun to watch the movie. So talk a little bit about your inspiration for making Evil Everywhere.
Well, I was really inspired by 1980s horror films in general. And so when I was making this, I wanted to kind of try to make something that like seemed like it could be a 1980s foreign horror film. One of those films that like it's lost in translation a little bit. It's right. Kind of disjointed. It probably was recut several times and like passed around to different theaters. So you kind of get a print that's like jumpy and sort of disjointed. And I really kind of leaned into the fact that I didn't have a budget or a crew. It was just me like funding it as I went. So, you know, for all intents and purposes, like I could only do so much at a time. And I sort of made that work for me by having that be part of the overall theme of the film, is that it kind of plays like it's sort of a joint or a disjointed, janky kind of horror film. And I think that my entire intention was just to make something funny that's sort of tongue-in-cheek and comedic, but sort of plays straight, takes itself seriously within the context of the film. But we were all very much in on the joke. So I think hopefully people enjoy this and understand that it, you know, the cheesiness is intentional. And a friend did point out that there was a review of it that kind of seemed to have missed the point and is getting really critical of like, you know, the bad acting and stuff like that. I mean, take into account, most of these actors are not actors. They were just friends of mine. And it was done, you know, it's super, super indie and DIY.
And I think some people now, especially this isn't like a blanket statement, but with the internet and everyone now being a movie critic, I think some people do take themselves as critics far too seriously, which is probably why this person missed the point of what you were trying to do.
Yeah. But overall, I just saw a really, really amazing review on Rue Morgue, and I was just taken aback because, like, I've been making short films for years, but this is the first time I've attempted to do a feature. Mm-hmm. And I kind of got a little bit ahead of myself. I think people were like, why are you doing this? And I'm like, because I want to, because I love this. This is what my life is about, creativity. My life is about creating art, movies, music, acting. And I don't do this because I'm being paid. I do this because I love it. And then, yeah, you know, the pay will come down the line. But I'm always just aiming to make something that I feel is exciting and I can put time and effort and love and passion into it and just have fun with it. And it was a real big experience that took me from 2017 until 2019 to complete this film.
Wow.
Before I eventually sent it to the distribution, and here we are. It's about to come out on the 25th.
So talk a little bit about the funding, because you said it was all self-funded. A lot of people, even in your position, would say, you know what, I'm going to do an Indiegogo or Kickstarter, which obviously you could have done. There are plenty of film fans who love independent stuff, who love original artists like yourself. Why did that just not occur to you to go that route? Or, again, was it just leaning into the no budget?
No, it's because I don't have enough notoriety yet. And because I want to do amazing things and not wait for the audience to show up first.
Gotcha.
I kind of want to do these ambitious things and then get the audience down the line. I'm not one of these YouTubers who pumps out a video every week. I mean, it takes me time. It takes me time because I have to gather actors and resources and props and stuff like that. And, you know, I don't have connections like that, or I didn't, especially didn't back then. I had just come out of film school, but I did not have professional connections or connections to actors. So I really had to kind of assemble the pieces as I went along, and then I would add in things and sort of just go from there. But my goal in the future is definitely to start to get funding. I just don't want to discourage myself by having everything resting on this, you know, Kickstarter campaigns that don't earn any money.
Right.
I think that at some point I kind of want to put things out there and just sort of like spend money with the intention of, in the future at some point, people might like what they see that I've done and want to contribute to a Kickstarter in the future. I am making another film right now, and I was lucky enough to have somebody donate a nice portion of money to helping me build the sets and gather props. So yeah, this is the first time I've ever had like a proper budget though. So that's very nice, very exciting. And I think that with this film, I just tried to, you know, spread out the spending so I could, you know, have money to buy food and stuff.
Now, with that having kind of like a launching platform then with this donation, you got to start this. The 2-year process that you took with this last one, it kind of, I would think, having that time to kind of make it and do it right the way you wanted to, money or not, or no money, now that you've got money, are you still going to take a while to get it right? Or is that going to kind of help shorten the time frame before release?
I didn't take the time to get it right. It just took a long time because I had to wait for people to be available before I could shoot their scenes.
Okay.
So it was a lot of, hey, this is the actor, or the actors that I need for this scene, but they're not available until like 2 weeks from now.
Gotcha.
So it was very frustrating. It was actually very frustrating because I like to get things done in a relatively short time frame, or otherwise you're just kind of lingering and sitting around and going, well, you know, I'm free all the time. I can shoot this scene today if I had the actors available now, but I've got to wait for them. So it did take a longer time than I expected. And I did have a period of time where I was dedicated to focusing on music and I was playing with a band. So I took kind of a hiatus from shooting it. So I was like, you know what? I want to get more characters in here. I want to do more outrageous, bizarre scenes and just have more fun with it rather than jumping to another project right away. The film I'm doing now, I definitely want to try to get it done within a short time frame. That's why every actor I've been interviewing, I've been saying, do you have open availability? So if we wanted to do a couple of days in a row and just kind of breeze through a couple of different scenes, would we be able to do that? So I'm sort of vetting people to see who has open availability, because I'm not working, so I can shoot any day.
Yeah. And with the 80s genre, you know, obviously that's a lot of classic horror that I can think of off the top of my head were in the 80s. You chose the 80s, I think, part for that purpose. But obviously I'm old enough. I lived through the 80s. I was a little kid, so I've got a fondness for that particular decade. What was it that draws you to the 80s particularly?
I don't actually know, because I was born in 1992, but I'm just obsessed with the 80s. I'm in my apartment right now, and if you look at my apartment, it's just covered wall to wall with my own art, but then like movie posters, pop art, references to like New York artists like Jean-Michel Basquiat and Andy Warhol, and I love David Lynch and Richard Kern and Jim Jarmusch and Sonic Youth. And so all of this stuff sort of just kind of rubbed off on me in some form or fashion. I feel like I'm more into the 1980s pop culture and film and music than I am to anything modern. Like, I don't pay attention to modern music. I don't pay attention to modern films. And as a creative person, I felt like I had to kind of step away from looking at what other people are doing, so I don't try to like be like them. And yeah. I'm not trying to be like what's popular on TV. I'm trying to hone in on what I want to say as a creator and, you know, flex that muscle and just kind of get better at doing my own thing over time.
Yeah, well, I mean, you, so, in my humble opinion, you chose a great decade to be obsessed with, because I personally love the 80s.
Oh, same, same. It's a very vibrant and eccentric decade, and I'm a very vibrant and eccentric person.
It's a good match.
So it does, it has influenced everything I do, and I think that it's kind of made me stand out in a weird way, for better or worse, that like I'm very eccentric and out there, and a lot of people don't know what to make of it. But I find it really interesting, because that's what excites me about making films, is that my ideas don't sound a whole lot like what other people are doing. So that kind of inspires me to really go after them.
Yeah, and you, obviously you want to stand out in a field that a lot of other people are competing for. So that will only help you there, I would think, as well. And you compose the music, too. So as if writing and directing wasn't hard enough, you also do a lot of the soundtrack and the music and everything. So talk a little bit about having all those hats. Is that does it get exhausting? Are there times when you want to pass one of these jobs off to somebody else? Or is it just you like to have that amount of control and kind of really make the movie truly your own from top to bottom?
Well, it's a little of both. It's the fact that it would have been harder to get people to do stuff for me, because everybody asks for money that I don't have to give them. So I'm like, okay, well, you know, I could wait around for somebody to say yes and do this stuff for free. But what I found when I'm doing these sort of like passion projects of mine is that if you're not like super communicative or available and have the time to do this stuff, like I'm not going to make you like, you know, take time off your job to do stuff. Like, I'm not going to be a jerk about this stuff.
Right.
If you're really, really busy and I have to kind of wait on you for a long time, I'm just going to sort of figure it out myself. And I'm already a composer and a musician. So I did compose a bunch of pieces. And after a while, I did outsource to different friends for different soundtrack cues. There's like 4 or 5 different composers, including myself, involved in this movie. And I would have a buddy do, you know, a couple pieces here, another buddy do a couple pieces. But I tried to keep the sound more consistent, and I did compose the title track. I actually did find that after a while, when I was doing everything and handling all the tasks at once, I was like, oh man, I should really try to, you know, outsource some of this and get some help.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's a pride. I don't know if it's a pride thing. It's more so that I don't want to bother people, because everybody, I get tired of the song and dance where people go, "What's your budget?" And I'm like, "There's no budget, man. I'm paying using my pocket change here." I was like, I'm not making this film to get paid. I'm not making this film like with a budget. I want to be able to pay all you guys, but for the time being, I'm just sort of like, you know, building something.
Right.
I'm honing my craft, and then the goal is like, yeah, we'll get budgets down the line, and we'll make money from this down the line. But I just tried to handle things as best as I could, including the special effects and stuff like that. So it was a great learning experience as well, just doing the makeup and the rotoscoping effects and all that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, it's obviously a lot going on within you when you see the movie and you realized I've done all these things. That's got to be a source of pride for you as well. We're gonna take a quick commercial break. You're okay to stick with us for another segment?
Yeah, sure.
All right,
thank you very much.
Now, of course, we're going to come right back talking more with Mykee Morettini all about Evil Everywhere. Please stand by.
Hey guys, this is Raoul Coley, and I play Dr. Ravi Chakrabarty on the CW's iZombie, and you're listening to Geek to Me Radio.
Yeah! We are back. Want to make sure I mention our official movie sponsor, Marcus Theaters. Marcus Theaters Movie Tavern. A bunch of movies coming out. It almost feels like we're getting into summer blockbuster season for real this time, since we missed it last year due to COVID. But Cruella comes out on May 28th, along with A Quiet Place Part 2. A lot of movies slated to come out soon. No better place to see them than at a Marcus Theaters or a Movie Tavern location. If you go to the website, marcustheaters.com, you can click on the location, find the one closest to you. You can buy your tickets right there on the website as well. You can browse movie reviews. They've got a special going. If you show your vaccination card, you get a complimentary popcorn right now. So that's fun. And also, all snacks, 20% off if you order them online or with the mobile app using the coupon code shown on the website. Get out and support movie theaters, because that's one of the things I missed sorely during COVID, was being able to go out and see a movie on the big screen. Marcus Theaters is doing it safely. They're bringing them back safely. Social distancing, like I said, the app lets it be a more contactless experience for the movie purchasing and concessions ordering if you want to go out and check a movie. And private cinema. Get a private cinema for $99. I believe it's through the end of May, if I'm not mistaken. You and 20 of your friends, you may have been already quarantined with some people, go out and see a movie at a theater. Just 20 of you. Private cinema. You can book that on the website as well. Once again, MarcusTheaters.com is that website for the best movie-going experience in the galaxy. Chatting for the rest of this segment with Mykee Morettini about his work on Evil Everywhere. He's a writer, director, some other projects coming up as well. One of the things that always fascinates me is with the horror genre. I know you mentioned some of your influences like David Lynch and things. Who are some of your go-tos when you think of great horror, either acting or directing?
I'm a really big John Carpenter fan. I really like sort of the low-budget horror camp, like trauma films, the films of Frank Henenlotter, like Basket Case,
yeah,
Frankenhooker, that kind of silly stuff. The films of Charles Band, like Terror Vision and, you know, the Full Moon features. I kind of like the silly stuff that kind of great practical effects and sort of a cheesy vibe about them. I love that stuff, and I was really kind of trying to evoke that with Evil Everywhere as much as I could. There's, of course, references in Evil Everywhere, or homages, rather, to Nightmare on Elm Street and things like that, Hellraiser. When I got into horror when I was a teenager, I mostly only liked the 1980s horror because it had the right elements combined. The silliness, the style, I loved the style of it. The look of it, the feel of it, the practical effects, the synthesizer soundtracks.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Just everything coming together. It really influenced me. Just all of those B horror films in general.
And I know you said you're not a huge fan of modern. What was just off the top of your head, like the most modern horror film, most recent, recently released horror film that you've seen?
The most recent. I saw Hereditary in theaters and it traumatized me. So people are often like, they think of me like, people tend to assume that I'm a big horror fan. I'm like, to be specific, guys, I'm more of like I'm a big 80s B movie fan. I'm a big 80s exploitation fan. But I feel like in this day and age, I've really had to check my mental health and sort of step away from some of that really gruesome, aggressive stuff.
Sure.
I'm kind of a sensitive guy. I think it kind of blows people away because I'm like a sensitive, you know, positive sort of guy. And I make all these really violent films. But I always tell people like, this is how I channel sort of that messed up energy into something tangible.
Sure.
I tend to not like to bog myself down with like heavy material on TV. Like I stopped watching The Walking Dead probably at the second season because it just became too daunting for me. But yeah, like the things like Toxic Avenger and stuff like that, it's kind of more funny and fast paced. You don't really believe it, what you're seeing on screen. It's sort of, it takes you out of it a little bit because it's just so far fetched. But yeah, I think when I saw something like Hereditary, it was just a little bit too messed up. I think it didn't really scare me so much as it just like struck something really deep inside of me and triggered some traumas. And I kind of walked out of that theater a little bit stunned.
Yeah.
And it wasn't very an enjoyable situation, but I will say I did really, really like It Follows. I thought that was, it was scary and effective, but it didn't like F me up. Like I didn't think about it for days and I wasn't like afraid that stuff was going to happen in real life. So I really liked the way it was directed and shot. It really evoked that same sort of John Carpenter feel, especially with the soundtrack. Initially it was seeing It Follows that really got me thinking, you know what, I'm going to go back and do another 80s horror thing. And that became Evil Everywhere because I've made a lot of, you know, fake grindhouse trailers of 80s stuff and, you know, 80s short films. But I was like, you know what, screw it. I'm going to do the full feature and I'm going to commit to that, and no side projects. I'm just going to do that. I thought it was just the right time. And then Twin Peaks, The Return was happening concurrently. So I would watch Twin Peaks, The Return and be like, all right, cool. Like, I want to, you know, twist this in a more surreal way and kind of pay homage to Twin Peaks a little bit. So it kind of just became a smorgasbord of all kinds of things.
And Evil Everywhere is out on DVD and digital. You said it's out this week, this coming week?
Yeah, it's on the 25th.
25th, perfect. And they can watch it where they can stream it, obviously, if they want to do digital or go out and buy the DVD. I'm a person who always likes to have the physical copy in my hands. That's the way I work. But with horror, I know you said Evil Everywhere is done. You're working on another project. Is this new project, and if you can't say, that's fine, is it a sequel? Does it have tie-ins? Is it going to be like an Evil Everywhere trilogy you're working on, or is this a completely separate movie?
This is a completely separate short film. After Evil Everywhere, I've made quite a bit of films. That's why it's kind of odd that it's coming out now, because I finished this film, you know, Evil Everywhere, I finished it in early 2019.
Oh, wow.
And then proceeded to make many other short films and three episodes of a web series called Captain Fantasy that I star in. So it's kind of surreal because the entirety of 2020, I made just mostly all comedies. Mm. One of my latest films that I've released is called Crime City, and I've been submitting that to festivals and getting, you know, a couple of festival placements. And it's just a big, long 16 minute grindhouse trailer where it's just the whole joke behind the short is that it's a crime city. It's a movie that's all about crime and it has no rule or order and everybody's a criminal committing crimes against each other. And it just kind of amplifies. It keeps getting more and more ridiculous as it goes on. And then at the end, everybody realizes that this doesn't make any sense. But the only thing they can think to do is just continue doing what they've done and just keep committing crimes. And so right now, the film that I'm about to make is more of a straight psychological thriller. And I'm not going for the comedy angle. I'm not going for the B-movie angle. And it's not an 80s film. So I have different layers and different flavors that I like to kind of dabble in. Eventually, I do hope to do an Evil Everywhere sequel. So it would then end up being a trilogy because Evil Everywhere in and of itself is the second film to a short film that I made years prior, which is kind of like, it's more of like an Easter egg or a little trivia bit because nobody needs to really see the first film to get this. It's just going to play as its own kind of ridiculous encapsulated experience. I definitely have thought about that, to doing a follow-up to Evil Everywhere, and I have a couple of different ideas. Again, I think that that would be something that would be a much bigger project. So I'm sort of going for what is feasible right now. And so the film that I'm tackling right now is more of a short bottle movie that takes place mostly in one location.
Hmm. And last question before I let you go, let's say, you know, 5-10 years, let's say you're in Hollywood, you get unlimited budget, you can cast whoever you want. With that premise, what type of movie are you making, and who's someone you'd really like to work with as an actor? Like I said, just no, sky's the limit.
I don't know. How about a Basket Case sequel?
Okay.
I'd kind of want to see a Basket Case sequel, like a proper sequel, like pick up after Basket Case 3. Don't do a reboot or anything like that. I know they're making a Tank Girl movie, but I'm a big fan of Tank Girl.
Yes.
And I would love to do, I have Tank Girl posters all over my apartment. And I think the original movie with Lori Petty, I love it for what it is. She did a fantastic job, but I would like to kind of take a crack at doing my own sort of Tank Girl type thing.
Hmm. That's, I would love to see. Again, I'm older than you. So I saw that one on the big screen, when I was in college. That's how old I am, but it's one of those movies I've just always loved.
It's its own thing, and that's what I like about it.
Absolutely. And if people want to find out more, keep up with you. I know your website is super stylized. I didn't even mention your website, by the way. It's very well done, very stylized. It's MykeeMorettini.com. We'll put a link to the website in the show notes. Are you active on social media? Anything else other than the website? People should be able to keep up with you.
Yeah, definitely. I have pages for everything I do. I've got the Mykee Morettini art page on Facebook. I've got the Mordacious Films page on Facebook. I've got the Moonbear Star Tiger page on Facebook. I keep busy because I like to keep busy, not because I need to. YouTube.com/Mordacious Films. You can see all the other short films that I do beyond this one.
Perfect. So they can go to YouTube and see the beginnings of Evil Everywhere, and then they can buy the DVD or catch the digital.
Yeah, definitely.
Perfect. This has been great. I always love talking movies. Mykee Morettini, I hope everything goes well, continued success, and we'll have to have you back on when the new one comes out.
Thank you very much for having me.
Anytime. Be well. Take care.
Bye-bye.
And we're going to take our next commercial break. We're going to come right back and do our big Pensacola wrap-up. We'll kind of get into the nuts and bolts of Pensacon, first con after COVID. We'll talk to our friends from Tatooine Sons and more. Stand by.
Hi, this is Chin Han, and you're listening to Geek to Me Radio.
Chin Han, you're hearing that soundtrack from the Dark Knight trilogy in the background. Comic books. Huge. Love comic books. Everyone who knows me knows this. If you want a good place to buy comic books and you're in this area, the greater St. Louis, St. Charles area, head over to Justin's Comics. Justin Comics is on with us as a sponsor for this month. Big assortment of back issues. He buys collections, so if you're looking to sell your collection, you might want to ask him. He will pay a very fair rate. He's always looking, and that's why he's always got some great inventory as well. Toys, comics, lots of stuff in store, lots of great back issues. Some stores you go into and they don't have a lot of back issues. It's all modern stuff. That's not a problem at Justin's Comics. And I'm a sucker for variant covers. Justin's Comics has a ton of variant covers. So if you're trying to find one of those hard to find 1 in 50 releases that the publisher puts out, check out Justin's Comics. You can also go online if you're outside the greater St. Louis, St. Charles area and want to check him out, justinscomics.shop. And if you're here locally, again, 25% off new comics on Wednesday, which is always great to save yourself some money as we're recovering from the pandemic. We can all use a little extra pocket change, and Justin's going to help you out with that. Once again, justinscomics.shop is the website. Check them out right over there in St. Charles, and tell them that you heard about it on Geek to Me Radio. Talking about comics, Pensacon. This is my first big convention since COVID hit. I was in Gallifrey 1 in Los Angeles in February of 2020, and that's right before everything kind of went into lockdown. Right now, we're joined by David from Tatooine Sons, a Star Wars podcast, someone I just kind of connected with online, who is also at Pensacon this weekend. David, how are you?
I'm doing great. Thank you so much for having me on the show. I'm excited. Oh,
glad to have you on. Like I said, it's just one of those serendipitous things. I think I commented on your Chewbacca post because he was standing right behind me in Ashley Eckstein's line, so I snapped a picture with him. But that's kind of so you have a completely different take, obviously, from me on cons, as everyone who goes to these cons. How did you enjoy Pensacon this year, and have you gone in the past?
This is my first Pensacon, mostly because we literally just moved to this area 3 weeks ago.
Oh, wow.
And so we're excited to have been able to participate. It was a great con. It felt so good to be able to hang out for 2 or 3 days with all of our fellow nerds after, you know, being locked up in our own little nerderies individually for the last year and a half or so.
Exactly right. Yeah, this was also my first Pensacon. I flew in from St. Louis. And so where were you based at before this one?
We were in Orlando for a year. And then before that, we were in Colorado.
So you got some nice cons through there. MegaCon Orlando, that's a big one.
Yeah. Unfortunately, they didn't get to have it last year,
right.
So we didn't get to be a part of it. So,
yeah. So, do you remember what the last con you attended was before the pandemic hit?
Yeah, we went to a small con in August of 2019 in Colorado Springs, Colorado Springs Comic Con, and then before that, the big one that we did was Star Wars Celebration in Chicago in April of 2019. Yeah,
that's another one. I've not been to a celebration yet. I'm almost kind of overwhelmed by crowd sometimes. So I think as much as I'd love to go to San Diego, New York, and a Star Wars celebration, I also wonder. I'm like, am I just going to be totally overwhelmed by how many people show up to those? Because those are huge.
Yeah, 75,000-80,000 people in Chicago in April of 2019. It is big, but the venue is usually spaced out well enough that you don't feel too overwhelmed. And it's so much fun hanging out with all of it. Especially, it's different at a celebration versus a traditional con, just because everybody at the at Star Wars Celebration are. Have the same fandom, and so that makes it a really unique experience.
And as we mentioned, you host Tatooine Sons, which is obviously it's a Star Wars based podcast, so that's your wheelhouse anyway, so it would make total sense for you to go to Star Wars Celebration.
Right, right. Yeah. And yeah, that, in fact, our first, our podcast was birthed out of attending Star Wars Celebration in 2017 in Orlando. So we were, that inspired us to start the show in itself. So
obviously, you've got two sons, I believe, who you do the podcast with.
I do. Samuel, who's turning 20 tomorrow, and then Nathan, who's 15.
Happy birthday to Samuel early.
Yeah.
So that's got to be something, obviously, as a dad, you passed on your love of Star Wars. Was that something that, or did they find their own way into it, or was it just something you've always been into, so they kind of picked it up as well?
Yeah, for me, it was really an amazing process to watch it come together. My sons and I, you know, had very different hobbies and likes, you know, for most of their, you know, early childhood up to when we started the show in December of 2017. So Samuel was 16 and Nathan was 12 at the time. And we didn't really have any common hobbies or anything. And then when the Disney era of Star Wars began, they began to get exposed to some of those properties. And then they got into Star Wars Rebels. This was a really fun moment because I grew up a huge original trilogy fan. I was a massive Star Wars fan. And I, you know, obviously I was at the midnight premieres of the prequels and when those came out. But Star Wars was sort of something in my past. And then when Sam and Nate got excited about it, I realized this was the opportunity to find something that we could all do together. And so they got into it in a big way. We started watching the shows, the films together. Star Wars Rebels was a big one, but like I mentioned, for us. And then it just grew from there. And it's become something that has really, it's changed our life. We've had so many amazing opportunities given to us. And it's every week we get to spend time together talking about something that we love, and it's really helped kind of bond us in a unique way.
And I know a lot of people, there's obviously a bit of a different look. You're going to look at it differently than they are as far as, you know, your view of the franchise and everything like that, and then
right.
them coming in so
mm-hmm.
with a different. So where, obviously, fathers and sons, they argue about stuff. Where do the main differences lie in your love of Star Wars versus their love of Star Wars, and what are some issues you guys kind of butt heads over?
Well, you know, we've got a rule when it comes to Star Wars that all Star Wars is good Star Wars. You just don't have to like everything the same amount. So we try to keep it pretty light side when it comes to when it comes to Star Wars. I would say one of the really interesting way to describe the differences is this finale of season 2 of The Mandalorian. When I'm watching it as a Luke Skywalker super fan growing up, and they're watching it as a Rebels fan. And so when that X-Wing shows up and a Jedi gets out wielding a green lightsaber, I'm excited thinking it's Luke Skywalker, and my kids are thinking, man, maybe that's Ezra Bridger from Star Wars Rebels. And
right.
so the experience was very different. So that's the kind of things that end up happening a lot.
But they've obviously seen the other stuff, so were they surprised? But because that's what I know, the big talk of Ezra Bridger coming in, possibly season 3 of The Mandalorian, now that they've kind of tied Grand Admiral Thrawn in with Rosario mm-hmm. Dawson's appearance there in The mm-hmm. Mandalorian. So that's still a possibility that we'll get some Ezra Bridger in it.
Right, yeah, and we're pretty much banking on the main plot line of the new Ahsoka series when it comes out being Ahsoka going after trying to rescue Ezra Bridger and find Grand Admiral Thrawn. So they're pretty excited about that as well.
And obviously, like the show I do, it's kind of pop culture based. So it's obviously Star Wars is in there, but I often
right.
feel like I'm covering so many other things. There's comic books, there's movies, there's, we just had a director on, Mykee Morettini, talking about his horror movie. Star mm-hmm. Wars, you're focused on that field. I imagine that would be a bit of a double-edged sword because you've got, you know exactly what you can talk about, but then also, does it ever feel like, oh my gosh, what if we run out of stuff to talk about? How do you kind of draw that line for yourself?
Yeah, that's definitely been a challenge throughout the 3.5 years that we've done it. A lot of times we'll end up talking about themes for a while. We'll do a whole 10-episode miniseries on the Jedi or the villains or just different. We like to talk about character lessons you can learn through Star Wars, and so we'll deal with some of those types of things. And then about 3 months ago, we started to find that the well was running really dry in between The Mandalorian and when we didn't even know when The Bad Batch was going to come out. And so we were talking a lot of other stuff. My youngest, Nathan, is a massive DC Comics fan and Batman fan. And he was, we'd end up talking about some of that on the show. And then my oldest loves Marvel. We all love the Marvel stuff, but really loves the MCU. And so with WandaVision and Falcon and Winter Soldier, we were ending up talking about these things on the show regardless. So we rebranded about 3 months ago to becoming just a more general pop culture podcast. But at the same time, when your title is Tatooine Sun, Star Wars is going to dominate the conversation.
So one of the rumors that's going around right now, since you mentioned MCU, is that we might see Brie Larson as Mara Jade now that kind of looks like Dave Filoni and they're kind of maybe building up some of the Legends line. Have you had any thoughts on that casting?
You know, I'm concerned about bringing in Mara Jade just from the perspective of George Lucas really didn't care for that character, and Dave Filoni is so close to George that I'm worried about that being something that he wouldn't want to do. And the fans love Mara Jade, but just like we saw with Thrawn, the Thrawn of the Disney era had a lot of similarities to the Legends era, but he's a very different character.
Sure.
And some of the original Thrawn fans didn't like some of the changes with him. I'm really concerned with Mara Jade because you've got Mara Jade so closely tied to Luke Skywalker that if she doesn't become, you know, the Emperor's hand who turns to the light side, ends up becoming a Jedi along with Luke Skywalker and marrying and having his kids, can it really satisfy the fans that are looking for her? And that's a big concern for me.
And just the fact that I'm not bashing on it, but just the fact that Disney Star Wars era has been divisive. I'll put it like that amongst fans, that there is possibility that
like
they could.
You're talking to a massive Last Jedi apologist. I mean, that's like our favorite movie. I'm standing here right now looking at a poster from Star Wars Celebration in Orlando, autographed Last Jedi poster, autographed by Rian Johnson.
Oh,
so,
wow!
We're huge fans of that. But I totally understand where you're coming from.
Yeah. So I know that just that divisive fandom. I don't think there's any way. I shouldn't say there's any way, because The Mandalorian did make a lot of people happy. But I don't think no matter who you cast as Mara Jade, somebody's going to be upset about it. I think so. That's a lot of pressure to put on Brie Larson's shoulders.
And she's already kind of a divisive actress on the front end. Captain Marvel wasn't as well received as some would have hoped, and so putting her in a position like that again would be really hard on her.
And while we're talking casting, you just mentioned because there's been a lot of people who say, "Oh, I'd love to see Benedict Cumberbatch as Grand Admiral Thrawn." Have you and your sons kind of brainstormed who you'd like to see be cast when they do bring Admiral Thrawn into the Ahsoka series?
Yeah, well, Benedict Cumberbatch has gone on record saying he doesn't want to play Thrawn.
Right.
So I'm pretty confident that we're not going to get that. We've landed solidly on just let Lars Mikkelsen play him again in live action. He voiced him in the Rebels series and did fantastic. He understands the character. He knows the voice is going to be the same, obviously. And he's a great live action actor. What he did in the season 3 of Sherlock was fantastic. And of course, you know, he give him an opportunity to play a live action character in Star Wars like his brother. So that would be a lot of fun.
That would be. That'd be very cool. Nice tying everything together there. And before we let you go, let everybody know if they want to find out more about your podcast and catch up with you. You've got a great website. Tell people where they can keep up with you on social media and everything else.
Yeah, anything you look for, just type in Tatooine Suns. That's S-O-N-S. We're on socials under that. You can search on any podcatcher out there looking for it. And if you're really wanting to see something cool, search on YouTube for Rian Johnson. Let's a kid name a Star Wars character. You can see when my son got to name one of the characters in The Last Jedi.
Wow, that's right. One of the Porgs, I think you said, correct?
Exactly.
That's awesome. Porg. That's very cool. Well, see, that's got to be one of the reasons why you love that movie so much. If you get to name one of the characters, that's huge.
Yeah, well, we watched the movie 10 times before we saw we had that opportunity. And so it all kind of came together for us in that moment, though.
Very nice. David of Tatooine Sons, thank you so much for your time tonight. I'm glad you enjoyed Pensacon, and maybe I'll catch you at the next one.
Yeah, we'd love to see you.
Take care. Thanks so much.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.
We're going to take our next commercial break. We're going to come right back, and we're going to give you a little bit more take on Pensacon, and we're going to talk to Ashley, one of the marketing people there, about how they reopen and coming back. All that and more. Stand by.
Hi, guys. It's Emily Swallow. I have two things to tell you, one of which is This Is The Way. And you are listening to Geek to Me Radio.
Emily Swallow, just one of the many guests who attended Pensacon 2021. They had a great lineup of Star Wars people, which obviously we just talked to David from Tatooine Sons. That's one of the reasons he was there, I'm sure. They had Ashley Eckstein, who voices Ahsoka Tano, the voice of Grievous. They had a couple people who played, obviously, the live parts for Boba Fett. Some of the handlers, like the Yoda puppeteer, a lot of great stuff. And they had a guest from across the fandom. Like, I got to meet George Wendt from Cheers, which I grew up in the 80s, loved Cheers. But it was a great con. We're going to give you an interview here with one of their marketing people in a moment. But first, I'll make sure we tell you about our premier sponsor, because this show would not be on the air without the help and support of the City of St. Charles, the Greater St. Charles Convention and Visitors Bureau. Now, there's a St. Louis thing. We've kind of talked about it before on a couple different shows, that people in St. Louis, for some reason, don't like to cross a bridge. And they're like, well, I'm not going over to Alton because there's a bridge that takes me out. I don't want to go to St. Charles because there's, you know, I got to go to the bridge. It's a weird thing, and I'm not sure if it's a St. Louis thing or not. Who knows? But one of the greatest experiences, if you've not been to St. Charles, is just going over there and seeing all there is to see and do. There's all the historic buildings, if you're a history buff. I always notice a lot of people taking senior pictures there because there's a lot of historic places and a lot of great backdrops when the light's right there to get pictures taken. A lot of wedding people get pictures taken, too. We're in wedding season. I'm assuming weddings are back on due to COVID. Joey, you're not getting married this spring, are you, that I know about? No? Okay. But yeah, lots of great places just do that. And that's just one of the things. So I could sit here all night and we'd take the rest of the hour to talk about all the great reasons there are to visit St. Charles. We mentioned the food before because I'm a fat kid. I like to eat, and they've got a lot of great places to eat in St. Charles as well. A lot of, not the corporate places, but a lot of little places. And that's a great thing, too. During COVID, a lot of these small businesses, Main Street stayed, and it's a lot of reason is that a lot of you went down and helped. You did the curbside pickup. You ordered online. And supporting small businesses, we learned how important that really is. So if you get the chance and you're in the greater St. Louis area and you're looking for someplace new to eat, you're looking for someplace new to shop, you want to kind of check something out, go over to St. Charles, check it out. You can check out the website to begin planning your trip at discoverstcharles.com. That's discoverstcharles.com. As we always say, it's an historically good time. Talking about Pensacon, my first big con, and I've talked with friends about, I'm not sure if Bill Blanky's listening, but he's heard me go on and on about how much I've missed conventions. And we're at Pensacon. One of the first things I want to do is talk to one of their marketing people about how things changed coming back. This is obviously their first con back since COVID, too. So we got a nice chance to chat with Ashley. We're here at Pensacon. We're talking to Ashley, who's the area manager for the marketing. And this is my first time to Pensacon. It's one of the first cons I've been to since the pandemic. Welcome back, first of all. How has it been coming back for Pensacon since the pandemic last year?
Yeah, we're excited that we were just able to make it happen, moving from February to May. We'll go back to February next year. But we're just glad we're able to put it on and that we're able to make it happen and still get a big crowd like we have today. We're definitely filling up, so we're excited to see everybody out in costume.
And I know some of the hotels I tried to book, and a lot of hotels were full. Is it normally this way? Pensacon just brings that kind of a crowd in?
It does, yeah, definitely. We highly recommend, as soon as the new dates for next year are announced on Sunday at 2:30, we recommend that you go ahead and start looking for your hotel room then and get ready for next year, because they do fill up, especially hopefully having the Crown Plaza back next year. It fills up super quick, like within the first few months after dates are announced.
And for those of you who are listening, there's food trucks and vendors out here in the parking lot. The lines are huge to get in. Were you kind of nervous opening? I mean, obviously you pushed back from February to May for the COVID restrictions, anything like that. Were you expecting this kind of crowd, larger, smaller? Where does this crowd fall in your expectations?
I actually think this is an amazing turnout, especially with everything that's been going on. I think people are ready to go back to normal, and especially with the CDC mask mandates loosening up a little bit. I think we're definitely seeing the crowd that we expected, and hopefully throughout the day, even more people will come and join us and come in on Sunday. We have tickets still available for Sunday as well, and day passes for today. So we're excited to see everyone out and hopefully get some sense of normalcy and get to meet some people. We have tons of, most of our celebrities didn't cancel, thank goodness. So they are here, they're ready to meet you, and they are ready to get back to normal just like everyone else.
And when you're planning this, I know obviously Ed Asner could make it, professional commitments, but there's still a lot of great people here to see. Is it were there any logistics as far as making sure you had carryover from people who were booked last year, celebrities who were anxious? I'm sure many of them are anxious to get back out of the convention scene too. If you could just kind of address a little bit about booking the celebrities for this coming back.
Oh, for sure. So I know Mike works really hard to book celebrities, and obviously with COVID, there are some people that couldn't make it because of their, you know, with COVID and everything going on. But a lot of the people that aren't able to actually be here have other professional commitments. They're getting back to work. They're getting back to their normal as well. So that's definitely been great to hear that they're getting back to work, and we're going to get to see some of the shows and movies and different things coming out that we've been waiting for over this past year.
Yeah, this is kind of the quiet before the storm. Hopefully it'll just get better and better from here as we go forward. Ashley, thanks so much for your time today. I appreciate it.
Yeah, you're welcome. It was great to meet you, and I can't wait to see what you put out over the weekend.
Thanks so much.
Yeah.
Very nice. She said her last name, but she said she was going by a different name, her maiden name, I think, for her business purposes. So just Ashley. So thank you, Ashley. But I do also want to thank Julio Diaz for the press pass and for letting me come in. It was a quick, I got in Saturday morning, headed straight to the con, did the con, and I literally flew out this morning. So a little tired, but it was a fun experience overall. Like I said, met George Wett, Fred Williamson, who was in one of my very favorite movies. Talk about B-horror movies, was From Dusk Till Dawn with George Clooney and Quentin Tarantino. Just a great movie, one of my guilty pleasures. But Fred Williamson was in that and played a great role as Frost. Got to talk to him. Hopefully we're going to have some of these guests on the show. I did set some stuff up with Fred Williamson and Denise Crosby. Shout out to her because she was absolutely wonderful to me, and we're going to have her on the show in the coming weeks to talk about her work in Star Trek and things like that. Just going to a con was everyone had the masks on, obviously. Even though people were vaccinated, they still had you required to wear the masks indoors. Some of the celebrities were still wanting you to have the mask, pop it down off over your chin when you were taking a picture with them. But it's still, we're finding our footing. But I think the cons are coming back is a great sign. The only thing I was a little discombobulated with the layout, because they had it at their downtown Civic Center, and it was like an episode of Lock and Key. You have to go through this hall to get to this floor, and you can only take the elevator down, but then you come back up the stairs if you want to get to the other room, but that person's going to be downstairs. So it was a little confusing to a novice. But the staff was super helpful, and we're always like, yep, let me tell you where this person is, and let me give you the best way to go. And the guests all appeared to be having fun. I talked to some of the vendors, because they obviously on the show floor, they had comic book people set up, people who came in from Colorado and Alabama to set up at this con, and they were just saying the price of comics, too. We were talking about the price of comics with one guy, and he said all the stuff is shooting back up. So I'm not sure if that's just a case of people haven't bought things for a while, and now post-pandemic, people are like, you know what? I want to buy comic books. So he said some of the comics that just last year would have gone for, let's say, $10 are now going for $30, $40, and $50. And the vendors are surprised as anybody else that the prices have kind of gone up. eBay drives a lot on that. And we're going to probably try to get someone on from CGC Grading in June to talk about how grading affects comics and everything like that. We've had someone on from them before, but I think that's just kind of interesting to find the business aspect of collecting, because a lot of people think it is a hobby, and there's a lot more that does go into it. But yes, thank you to Ashley. Thank you to Julio Diaz and all the staff at Pensacon for making it a great trip. My first con back since COVID, and it was a lot of fun. I miss them. Make sure you check out the show and subscribe here. Subscribe to us on YouTube. So if you're watching this right now, hit the little subscribe button and the bell, because we're going to be doing more conventions coming up. We're going to be hopefully doing Terrific Con in Connecticut and Planet Comic Con in Kansas City. And if I can squeeze it, if I can make it happen, Unicon in Las Vegas. And Ashley Eckstein will also be at that one. She's a wonderful person. And obviously, David Eckstein, former Cardinal. So there's that little connection there for the St. Louis people who are listening. That's going to do it. Another show in the books. Thank you again to Mykee Morettini. Evil Everywhere out on the 25th DVD and digital. Thank you to David from Tatooine Sons for his time talking Star Wars. It's always fun to talk Star Wars. And thank you to Pensacon. Until next week, my friends.
It's not in the way you watch I sound be. It's not in the way you watch the Flash. It's not in we'll be right back.
This is James Enstall, host of Geek to Me Radio, and I have a mission for you.
Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope.
The next time you want to buy something from Amazon, go to geektomeradio.com first and click our Amazon affiliate link. Simply shop like you normally would, and when you check out, a small percentage will go to supporting the show. So remember, the next time you want to search Amazon for the latest Game of Thrones Blu-ray or Sonic screwdriver, click through from geektomeradio.com first.
This tape will self-destruct in 5 seconds.